Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast presented by Manscaped. Yes, I still look homeless because my Manscaped kit has not arrived yet. I am your host, as always, Billy, and I am joined, well, I hopefully will be joined by Adam and Marcus King, but in the moment, I'm joined by Adam King of KoE. Welcome to the show.
Thank you. Thank you for having, well, me right now, but us. I'll speak for both of us.
Exactly. All right, you can answer all the questions. So we have Marcus on his way. He jumped in briefly, but his camera's not working, so we don't know what's going to happen. This could be an episode where I'll put out the thumbnail and it'll just be scored out. I'll score out Marcus and just have
a big crossover. He said,
"Aye, that's it. He hasn't made it." So, some of the questions we may repeat again once he comes into the chat, but it gives me a chance to speak to yourself directly, though. So it means I can get to know a bit more about Adam King and how he got started in wrestling, because Marcus was there first. He had like 2 years on you, so we'll get to that. But
nobody cares about that.
Exactly. First question is the usual. It's the usual classic podcast question. How did you get into pro wrestling? So what was your jumping off point, your hooked moment that got you into pro wrestling?
Generally, it's been since I was like 3 or something like that, because it was Marcus that obviously, he's a bit older than me, so he had all the videos and stuff when we were younger, all the sort of Attitude Era things. When I was very young, the first things I really remember was watching the Hardys. And I loved Jeff. So like most people, and Paul's a big Matt fan. Marcus is a big Matt fan. I'm sure he wouldn't mind me saying that. Marcus is a big Matt fan. So he's one of those strange ones. Oh, there he is.
There he is, finally. Well, I've got one question in before we got joined. Right, okay, so now we've got both in for people that are on the audio feed. We've got both KoE, Marcus and Adam King. That's how it should appear on the screen that people are watching, hopefully, fingers crossed, because you know me, I don't like editing anyway. Welcome, Marcus.
Thanks. I know, sorry, I don't know what was going on with my camera and my laptop, but I've got a spare laptop, my backup laptop.
So. I was just saying you're late to everything anyway, so it was completely expected.
I know, but to be fair, that wasn't my fault.
Well, you were already late before you actually went wrong, so...
So KoE stands for poor timekeeping. That's kind of the first one out the way. Yeah. Welcome. Well, we are recording now, just in case. I don't know if it comes up in the corner saying it is recording, but...
I got a wee voice notification going, recording in progress. Must be the update.
Oh, yeah. When I logged in, it was like 5 minutes to, and I thought, right, okay, I'll log in, I'll get ready, and it came up update available. Jesus. Not now. All the times, can you just know? My computer's doing the same. Going now, you can wait. You can wait until I'm out of hours. not that I use my work laptop computer for doing this. Right. Anyway. So yeah, welcome to the show. Welcome here. You swear you're fine. You can do all that. Like I've said to Adam, I just avoid slandering folks. So I don't want any pushback on anything that comes our way.
Don't worry. No time for that either.
Marcus as well. I've already called you your shoot name. So. It's not got off to a good start.
Nah, I hate people finding me on Facebook, man. You know that?
Oh, yeah. let's not talk too much about that. we're opposites in that regard.
Yeah, it's weird. I just don't like that. Like, too many people find me on Facebook, I'm like, come on.
See, it must be weirder for being a wrestler for that kind of thing. I mean, I get it as well from folk. Not as often, but it's like, no, leave me alone. if I haven't actually met you physically, even then, I'm still on the fence whether I'll want to add you or not to my life. But yeah, it must be weird for going to shows and that. And you'll have next day, all your requests will be so-and-so, like 24 mutual friends, and it's just been other wrestlers that have went, yeah, okay, accept.
Yeah. Get some good photos of yourself at shows and stuff like that, though. So you're missing out, Paul.
No, but you send me them. So. Hey,
you're missing out, Marcus.
This is going to go swimmingly, I can tell. Yeah. right, so I asked Adam how he got into wrestling. He mentioned the Hardy Boys, which is great. It's always a checkpoint for me because I'm a massive Hardy Boys fan, to the point of getting a tattoo of their logo on me. Marcus, people want to call you your previous ring name. Marcus, how did you get into pro wrestling? What was your hook moment?
I think, like, it's weird because I don't know if Adam mentioned it, but none of our family watch wrestling. Like, even now, when we've been doing it, like, cousins, mum, dad, nobody ever watched it. But my friend watched it, like an old family friend, and they used to just kind of, I always remember, and I don't, it was a Monday Night Raw, and it was Triple H versus Big Show. It's my earliest memory watching it in the family friend's home. And I always remember Triple H overload Big Show at one point, I'm pretty certain, or at least did something sneaky. And I remember being the first time, I was like, what is this? And they had a Rock video, like his documentary at the time. Must have been like the late 90s. And I just remember watching that and being hooked. It was a whole story about him and Mankind and, you know, the empty arena match and things like that. And that was like a very early memory, but I didn't really watch it. I just remember being, that was amazing. But I never watched it at home. And then the second memory I have is The Rock running down Booker T on SmackDown. Like the first, I think it's the first time we meet.
Yeah.
And I was just, after that, I watched it every week. Like Sky One, I watched SmackDown 11 a.m. Always remember it. If my mum didn't force us to go to mass, I'd sit and watch SmackDown. Like, so that was kind of like, yeah, how I got into it. And then I kind of went off it. I think, I don't know if you remember, you might remember, Billy, like, you know, you had Virgin Media and Sky, still do it, but Virgin lost the rights to Sky One or to use Sky. So I never watched it because we ended up with Virgin. So we never had Sky and I just didn't watch it. And then I remember we got it back. We got Sky later, like years later, 2008 maybe. And the first, I was up at like stupid o'clock in the morning and it was Jericho versus Mysterio at the Bash live. The one with the, like, he takes the mask off and he's got the other mask in it. And obviously I recognised the two wrestlers from before. And it was I think it got match of the year. So it was like the best match to get back into wrestling. And after that, I started watching it again. I think the next night I watched Raw.
You missed it a period there. You know, we were TNA kids.
Oh, aye, we were big TNA fans.
You guys, I like you guys. Because of all the things you mentioned so far, it was starting in the late 90s, which is when I started watching wrestling. And then I had on digital and onto ITV digital. So it kind of kept Sky One for a little bit longer. And we'd get to watch Metal. If I didn't go to Sunday school, to run home from Sunday school if I wanted to watch Metal, I'd see an SA Rios match. And TNA, Wrestling Channel would have been the TNA.
It was on free as well, remember? I think it was like, what was it, Bravo? Was it Bravo it was on? It was on like a preview channel.
It was Bravo,
And I remember watching quite a lot in like Christian, because I was, again, recognising names, Kurt Angle, Christian. We really liked Matt Morgan. And
The Blueprint.
AJ Styles, obviously, like, brilliant.
Mojo,
right. That's more now though, but at the time, like,
it was great at the time.
It was always been good. I just mean, like, as a fan.
TNA stuff was ace. I mean, my first experience, that was 2004, I think it was Turning Point. It was the Cage Walk. It was the first time.
So good.
First TNA show I taped. So it was like 4 hours long because it was on the Wrestling Channel, so I had ad breaks as well. So I had to put on the long play of the VHS so I could make sure I got all of it. TNA, it was just great. And then, honestly, for me, it was when I moved out of my house, moved out of my family home, and I didn't have Sky Plus or anything like that. So I had to catch it when I could on Freeview. And that was the point where I kind of lost my way with it a little bit. But, TNA, you mentioned all the really great ones. Daniels as well, Christopher Daniels, Shark Boy. I loved a bit of Shark Boy.
EY, Eric Young,
great guy.
Super Eric, when he was Super Eric as well, when he became
Walking out to when we were on the shows with him, you know.
Clive Valley, was it? Was Clive Valley you were on
the
shows?
That and the Iron Girders, yeah.
Yeah.
Of course.
Really nice guy, like, really nice guy.
Is one of those where you were looking at him going, I mean, I don't know if for wrestlers meeting wrestlers it's the same, but was it a case of you just looking at him going, I mind when you won the, when you were tag team champion, when you were beer drinking champion, when you were team with ODB, or are you just like, no, I'm a professional at this moment in time?
Yeah, it's so strange, like, seeing people you grew up watching and you like meet them in person and all that, and you're on the same sort of shows as them. It's just such a bizarre feeling, you know. But you know, you're kind of looking at them thinking, I shouldn't be right that I'm sitting here talking to you,
I just had a similar experience. I've mentioned it in a previous podcast, meeting Billy Gunn for the first time, and I love me Billy Gunn. He's ace. He was one of my favorites in the Hatched era.
Yeah.
He was called Billy, which helped. But yeah, when I met him, it was the first time I met a proper, one of the first times I met a proper wrestler outside of Dundee, the first Aberdeen show I went to. And I met him and went, I loved everything you've done, even the one Billy Gunn or whatever it was. And I was like, why? No, even the smoking guns. Why did I say that to myself? Like, No, not even. Yeah. Did not need the word even in that conversation at all.
I love the worst part of your career.
I loved rockabilly.
He was always good. Yeah.
Billy and Chuck. I love that gimmick. Billy and Chuck. So good.
Final four in the Royal Rumble 2001. Never forget Billy Gunn.
What a huge man.
I like guys. See guys like that though that can like take anything and make it good. Like Cody Rhodes was the same. Like Stardust, the Dash, and like see guys that can do anything. Like you go, here's something quite silly. Like, cool. I'll make it amazing. Like that's Billy Gunn, and it like, just makes things good, no matter what.
It still is. Still, I mean, I don't watch a lot of AEW. Actually, just keep up with the results or what have you. But every time I see Billy Gunn, I'm like, you're just best. Billy Gunn's one of my boys. If there's any a boys list anywhere, Billy Gunn's on mine. Back to you guys wrestling though. So of course,
we're talking about us.
I know. We've got loads of questions, so that'll speak. I know we can do a whole episode of TNA, and I'd be quite happy. But I don't know if folk listening they're wanting to know about KoE.
Yeah, that's true.
Would be interested. So of course, Marcus, you debuted first back in 2016. So was it just a case of did you guys always want to be wrestlers, or was just you're a bit older, so you started first? How did you come about becoming a wrestler?
It was probably a longer period of time than probably anyone realizes, but I think I was 17, like, so this was way, way back, so I would have been 17.
You're only 19 right now.
I wish, man. And I remember I went to training for like 3 weeks or something, like, but I was like so skinny. Like, I mean, like Adam will tell you, like my upper arms were skinnier than my forearms type like situation. And I just remember being like, I was decent enough in terms of like physically I could do the things that needed to be done, but I felt so small. I was a wee boy and I felt like a wee boy. And I just stopped, went to uni, did that whole thing. And it's a weird one, but I was doing Interrail in 2014, and I remember sitting on a ferry, and I was just thinking, what am I doing with my life? Like, what have I wanted to do? What do I want to do? And because I was just working like in a retail like store at the time, like kind of trying to figure my way out. And then I thought the only thing I know I want to at least try and do is wrestling. So I was like, I'm going to get my driving license, going to get a car, and I'm going to drive to like, you know, go to training as much as I can. And I haven't really been always fans, and once I knew I could do it when I was younger, it was always in the back of my mind, but it wasn't until that sort of day when I was traveling and you get like that epiphany, that kind of light bulb moment, and I was like, I'm gonna do it. And then yeah, I just went and kind of stuck to it for a good bit. Changed all my shifts at work. Like I did anything to get to the beginners classes at first, and then when it changed to the fans and things like that, I just kept asking. I think I was like 4 weeks in, I was like, can I go and do matches? I just kept asking and asking. Like Lewis Garvin and Damo were the two main trainers when I was there originally. And I think Lewis just got fed up of me asking and just like, yeah, just go. And then I kind of got thrown in the deep end. I think I did a match like 2 months in, and I just got leathered. Like, I didn't know what I was doing. I was getting hit and I was standing back up and doing all the, like, you know, didn't know what I was doing. But I kind of learned that way, like going thrown in the deep end. And then I think I stopped for 6 months. Like, I hurt my back deadlifting like an idiot. And then when I was deciding to go back, I was saying to Adam, like, do you want to come back with me? Like, I will actually go for it. And I think it was January 2016, we really, was it 16?
15? Yeah, 16. I think at the start for me. Because I maybe went a bit before when you, like before that 6 months you were out, I went a couple of times. Mm-hmm. And a couple of experiences we had. So one was like a Drew McIntyre seminar. He came just after he got released from WWE. And we'd been like, what, two sessions or something like that, two training sessions. And he goes to us and he's like, oh, do you two know an international? Which is like, you know, the most basic thing in wrestling. So everybody that trains and wrestles knows an international, right? But obviously, we'd not been doing it very long. I think you knew what an international was. I didn't know. I was like, oh yeah, I know what an international is. And so we get in the ring and he goes, right, go. And I just kind of freeze up and I'm like, And Paul's like, Marcus is trying to grab me. And put me
said my name anyway on the corner, man. video. So,
what's that?
I'm saying kayfabe's done because it says my name and then.
Oh, it doesn't show up in there. It doesn't show up when I get the video. Yeah, when I get the video, it show up.
Don't want our second names up there, at least, you know. King, you know. And then I just froze up, and he was just like, you know what, just leave it, guys. And I remember thinking, oh, I don't know if this wrestling's for me. And then the next week, it was the first time I ever saw Damo, and it was probably the last time before he went away to WWE. But we were going around doing just simple walk-ups in a circle, and he was usually quite quiet in his seat, and we were practicing doing lock-ups. And basically, I wasn't doing it very well. And he gets up from his seat, which didn't happen often, and he just shouted at it, like, big scary Irish voice. You know, I'm a wee 17-year-old or something at the time. And I was like, nah, I'm not coming back. I'm too scared. He was like, you're not doing it properly, with more expletives. But yeah, I was like, I'll go away for a while. And then I came back a couple of years later. So.
And by the way, Damo's a hero, like, loving me bits like that.
Oh, he's lovely now.
His first experience with
him. Yeah, oh no, he's a lovely guy. Yeah, that was just, it was a bad first experience. He was a scary guy.
It's one of those things, I mean, for you guys, I mean, when you contacted me for an interview, I hadn't contacted you guys because I'd always seen you guys wrestle on, like, YouTube and what have you. And you're quite intimidating guys, or quite aloof guys. So I was like, oh, they'll never be interested in being on the podcast, so I just wouldn't bother. And that happens a lot of times for a lot of wrestlers. I'm just like, unless I get like maybe a couple ciders in me, I'm like, fuck it, I'm just going to DM this guy. Why not? Might work. Yeah. But I was like, they wouldn't be interested. They're quite aloof. And now hearing you guys just like, your first couple of years, you were terrified of Big Damo for a moment. And that was like almost you packed in. We may not never have seen KoE because Big Damo shouted at you.
Yeah. I know, to be fair, I was very, very young at the time. So matured a bit since then.
So was the team always kind of the idea? Was it always eventually you guys were going to be a tag team, or was there aspirations to one day like face each other instead or go your own paths, or was it always what was the team?
I think when I had debuted, and when Adam first came in, we also had different names. Like, we tried to have some similarity by having the King. I was also Tyrell, King Killer. But that was kind of purposely done to be similar but not the same. Like, just so we were going to do single stuff for a while, I think, because I was doing okay. I did like the two Drew Galloway tournaments. Like, I had a couple of really good matches. Well, at that, for my standard at the time, in terms of like being quite new and quite green, I was having decent matches. I mean, I was getting carried to decent matches basically. And so I was thinking, well, let's build up our singles names, and then we'll be a team. Like, then when we be a team, it's a bigger deal. That was the idea originally, and then we got booked on a show that was a closed door show, like, for fans, but there was loads of promoters there. That was the first time we met Dallas at like ICW, Scott Reed. I think Rudo was there, loads of other, I'm trying to remember like off the top of my head, but it was a lot of promoters, a lot of wrestlers that were there, and your family could go as well. So our mum and our granny were there, and they got asked to be a tag team for the main event, and we just went, aye, we'll just do it then. And then after that, we're like, might as well just do this now. Like, there was a gap at the time of being, you know, a fully marketed team. Even some of the teams that are good teams had really good individual wrestlers. And obviously, what we feel like we're in, good individual wrestlers as well. But we solely market, we solely sell ourselves, and we solely try and get booked as a team. And we just thought, who's better to do that than two brothers? And we enjoyed it, and we quite enjoy the tag team style of wrestling. We always have. And I think that main event, for the length of time we'd been doing it and the experience level of the six guys that were in the ring, it was good. Like, and that's what we went for.
I think a big problem initially as well was you were quite far ahead of me. So it was like, I'd be kind of holding you back if I came in too soon. And I probably was the first, you know, wee while. But I'd be holding you back if I came in and I was so far behind you and you'd been wrestling for a year and I was brand new to it and stuff like that. But yeah, it was a good decision to do it when we did. So
we were thinking, what, 2016-ish then? No, sorry, 2018 was when first note I've got as a team anyway. Maybe beforehand, that closed door one.
Yeah, 2018. That was a year.
January, wasn't it? Was it January? January
2018? Yeah, January.
I think so. I think it was against remember who I've got written. I didn't write it down because I would have been well too prepared.
Yeah, the first one was, again, I don't know if people knew about it because it was like it wasn't an announced show, but it was against the Govan team and
Underdogs.
That was the first. Couldn't remember that. I remember who was in the team, like Scott and Gia, but I couldn't remember the team. But that was the very first match, but I wasn't announced, or it's probably not even on record.
So I think it's yourselves versus the Underdogs is the first one on Cage Match anyway. That was the first as a team. Adam, you still don't have a Cage Match profile. I don't know if that makes a difference to your life at all.
Probably had more matches in me at this point as well.
It's quite terrible. I was so shocking that his screen's actually froze, which is even better. It may come back at some point. Adam mentioned the Hardy Boys as inspiration for him. He may mention it when he comes back into the chat. But for yourself, anyway, was there any tag teams that you wanted to kind of emulate or at least take notes from for KoE?
I think when we first got in, not massively so in the sense of we just wanted to learn. So we were like sponges, just, you know, didn't know where to even start when you first start, if that makes sense. So there wasn't really anyone. Like, we were big fans, obviously, the Hardys, the main tag teams. But I feel like as time's gone on, it's been more modern teams. And then going back and watching, like, you know, the Brainbusters and things like that. The Revival, obviously, are big, like, good team to watch. But, I mean, I love the Usos. Like, I think they're brilliant. I think they're almost underrated, I think, to some degree. Like, because they don't do, like, the most amazing stuff. Like, but everything they do is spot on. And if you watch their matches, like, the crowd can be flat at the beginning, but see, by the end, they literally have them way up here, which is just a skill in itself. Like, so that's probably, like, as time's gone on and we've got better, is to try and reach that standard, which is obviously hard. But I wouldn't really say that when we first started, we watched anyone. We've been quite big on, like, if you're trying to copy too many people, you just become a kind of ripoff. We've always tried. If you watch our moves, for instance, like, that's us in our own head thinking of what do we do as individuals, what's not been done. Like, the majority of our moves I've not seen, like, as a tag team. Like, there's, I think almost every singles move has been done to some extent.
Yeah, but
untapped amount of probably tag moves that people could pull off. But it was great learning. Like, we wrestled Mark and Jackie, the ball was a, like, massive learning. The Hunter Brothers was like, mind blowing way they fought, like, unbelievable tag team, the Hunter Brothers. We learned a lot from them, and just, yeah, every time we get somebody, we wrestle somebody better, we're just like sponges. Like, I think people have this perception of us is because of our characters that we're really arrogant, like you say, like aloof. Maybe to some degree we are in kind of real life, but, like, certainly want to get better and want to learn, and that's kind of been our sort of main focus is, like, big fans. The minute we became wrestlers, it's like, okay, who can we learn little things from? So, like, the Usos, we're never going to take a move they do, but we might think, oh, they've done something like that there. Can we do something similar that gets the same type of reaction?
It's the same. It's like, see, when every show we're at, and we'll ask whoever the most experienced person on the show is, we'll go and find them, and we'll go, oh, can you watch a match? And then if they'll give you, they'll give you maybe quite a bit of feedback, but there's always that one thing that clicks and you go, because it's hard to remember everything, but there's always one thing from, like, each experienced wrestler, and you kind of, it sticks in your mind and you go, right, I'm going to make sure I do that next time. And you just bring it with you every sort of match you have.
It's like that, the analogy I like to use for wrestling anyway, is like a puzzle. It's a puzzle at the end of the day. So you go to every match, you might get another piece to that puzzle, and then it'll add an extra bit of the picture, and you just kind of fill it out as you go along. So yeah, if as long as you're gaining the experience and finding the most experienced person to give you the feedback, then it just makes you guys a more cohesive tag team. And I suppose with guys like Mark and Jackie for the pole promotions as well, they would have had things like tryouts with WWE, stuff like that. So they would have not only brought the tag team stuff, but they would have had, right, these are what the big guys are looking for as well. They'll have that little bit of nugget of information to go with it. So it's all finding out all these little bits and pieces, I suppose, at the end of the day.
Yeah,
and I don't think there's, from experience, like, it's baffling how many wrestlers aren't asking, like, for feedback. Like, you know, you'd, I think it might just be a fear thing, but we've just always, like, I always think that's the best thing anyone could ever do in any show, is like, even if the most experienced guy is not that experienced in comparison to like a Mark or Jackie, for instance, they might be a slightly lesser level, but like, still ask them, because they may have picked up something along the way. And you can, you know, sometimes just like Adam said, somebody says something, somebody could have said something to me 100 times, but somebody else says it in a different way, and I'm like, wow, yeah. Like, and suddenly it like clicks in your mind, and it's just because a person said it slightly differently, and it, you just kind of figure it out as you go, and just keep learning like much as you can.
No, I get the fear part of it, because like I was saying, this is episode 187 of the main SWN podcast feed, so I've got KoE on, but I've never asked for feedback on episodes, because I don't want people telling me I do it wrong. It's like, no, I've got this far. That's fine. Just leave me be.
That's the hardest part, is like finding out, because if it's like something constructive and you go, oh, you could be better at that, and you're like, oh, it means I'm bad at it. It's terrible.
That's it. That's exactly it, because I'll be thinking, oh, the last 5 seasons have been absolutely worthless, then, because you could have done this instead. But you know, at the end of the day, my stuff doesn't change the world. I mean, wrestling can, you guys are superheroes for children and what have you, so it can change someone's mindset on something. I don't know. I'm waffling now. Anyway, right, KoE. So one thing that you put on Twitter is you don't want to be asked what does KoE stand for, which Maxwell Miller did ask on Twitter. So
I knew he would wind up.
So I will word it differently. Why KoE?
Do you want to take it, Paul?
I can't tell whether to be like genuinely serious about it or not, because we always just wind people up before it. So I'll say this, right? It did stand for something originally, and it's not what people think. I think people think it stands for Kings of Everything, and it that's never did. So, like, that's the biggest like misunderstanding of what KoE stands for. Like, I think that it came from a song, right? Which is a song by Wiz Khalifa called King of Everything. And I think I discussed it with one person, but it was never like, that's never what it was going to stand for. And they said, oh no, don't do that, because there's Kings of Cats, there's Kings of the North, like, it's just another king, like, what was the point? So that was the end of that. And I was like, we'll make it stand for something, I'll think of something else. And then it was something else. Didn't really like it. And then I think then we did the promo at ICW, when we debuted in ICW. I just rhymed off, like, people kept asking what it stood for. And it just clicked in our mind. It was like, why don't we just make a gimmick of this? Like, people keep asking.
Do you know why we stuck with it as well? Because I don't know if you remember this, but we got the logo done before. Right, we're not putting this logo to waste. We're sticking with KoE. We'll find something that it stands for.
Aye, because it was a cool logo. But then I think somebody said, like, I'm sure if you put it in, like, I don't know if I'm tripping, but you could check. If you put it in like Urban Dictionary, like the KoE is a word, like KoE spelled co or whatever you want, I don't know how you would say it, is like abundance of swag or something silly. Like, it was something strange, so it kind of worked. And then people just kept asking. And then we did the promo ICW, and we ran off like 4 or 5 different names for it. And then after that, every time somebody asked us, we were just like, let's just say something different. Like, kicks out everything, knockout establishment,
Knights of Equestrian.
Yeah, and spelling things wrong as well, like constantly over delivering excellence. I think it was an ADM one. Like, you know, we're happy to take on board suggestions. Like, but every time somebody asks us, we give them a different answer. But that is the truth of it, is it wasn't Kings of Everything, and it genuinely doesn't really stand for anything.
Right. So, for anyone wondering, so you don't have to, I just Googled KoE in the Urban Dictionary, and I couldn't have hoped for a better explanation. So KoE stands for a person with splendid taste in every subject, who is gorgeous, known for having a sexy deep voice and perfect hair and smile.
You don't have that perfect hair.
The rest of it. There we go. That's what KoE stands for in North. Right.
Fantastic.
Lovely. Right. So I'm just going to go into these questions. We'll ask about titles and all that kind of stuff afterwards. Actually, no. First question I want to ask. Right. Govan. So this is, I've watched the Govan shows when they come up on YouTube Source usually, and now Community Pro Wrestling. I heard a story that you may have got into a little bit of disagreement with someone in the front row at Govan show. Now, again, that's just hearsay from my end of things, but what are the Govan crowds like, and how have you found the Govan crowds?
I think we got involved in a few.
The one I remember most was when I was an outside. And the thing is, right, see when you're at the Govan crowds, they don't watch the wrestling. There's all these wild children just running about, jumping on tables and stuff like that. And basically, they'll come over the tables and try and fight you when you're on the outside. So they're trying to wind up whoever's on the outside. So I was on the outside, and this wee guy comes and like taps my leg or something like that, I don't know. And I get down and I'm squaring up with him. I'm like, right, let's go. Did he hit me in the balls? I feel like he hit me in the balls. He tried to super kick me, and he hit me in the balls. It wasn't fun. But there's not much you could do. I don't know what the security was. You need security for the kind of shows, but
and the parents don't care. I think because we first went in, we kind of did, every time we wrestled there, initially we wrestled the Govan team. So obviously we were massive heat magnets. And I think a good chunk for it, we were really hated on, we were really do it, like, and it just became like, it just got out of hand at times. But like he says, like, half of them don't watch the show, like, they're just wild, like, they're just there for like a wild night. it's mental, but yeah, they would jump over, like, you couldn't really say anything. Like, we did say something because we're always saying things like we're just winding people up, like, you know, taking like the inflatable hammers off them, like grabbing their bottles and throwing them across the room and stuff. It was just daft things. And then you think it's like a kind of, you know, you're getting trying to get a bit, you know, of a reaction, but then the parents are actually literally trying to fight you. Like, you got women like squaring up to you and stuff, and you're just thinking, Jesus, like,
yeah.
You know, it's a show. Swearing
like, in front of all the children and all that. It's terrible.
Like, I don't go about my day-to-day life as Marcus King and, you know, walking up with people and punched, like, you know, it's a show, like, that's not who we are, really, like, from, you know, on a day-to-day basis, but they seem to think that that's the case.
Yeah, I know. Near fights with parents, that's happened to a couple of shows.
It's like, you can't turn around and just go, like it's the real, kind of, that it's a show. You can't do that, because, of course, the kids are there as well, but I don't know how. I've only seen one, obviously a couple times now, but I saw a Rudo Lightning. He got squared up. He was up in the Northeast, won a belt off the big baby face Damien, and then after the show, he was getting squared up by a guy in the lobby, wanted to fight him because he cheated to win. And I was just seeing Rudo trying not to go, it's near real, to just calm down, it's a show kind of thing. I was like watching this going, how is this happening? How have you got to the point of this happening?
I'm not jealous. The wrestlers in the 70s and 80s had to deal with that, you know. Kayfabe was still a thing.
I have a pencil in their boots in case you had to chip someone. I don't envy anyone having to wrestle on the Govan shows. I mean, Alex Webb, I was speaking to, he pointed out that the first one they did, they came out in orange, and he didn't realize that was a bad idea until he got out there. And realised it was a bad idea to wear orange in a show.
Well, it's mixed, because technically, Govan's quite famous for being like a Rangers town. And we went there, and I was like, it was the first time we were meant to be wrestling there, we were wrestling against the Govan team. I was like, oh, I'm going to come out in a Celtic top, and everybody's going to be all wound up. And then we got there, and I think it was Davey, who's a Celtic fan himself. He was like, nah, it's very mixed in Govan, it's really not going to have as much of an impact as you think it will.
And in fairness to Davey and Xander, they often would come out, one would wear like a Celtic singlet, or Davey would wear the Celtic singlet, Xander would wear the Rangers, which is good. Like, you know, I mean, if you know Glasgow, like, there is that obviously real divide. So it's good that, like, because the kids do look up to them, as, you know what I mean? Like, genuinely they do. So if they're sitting there, Celtic and Rangers, and they're a team and they're cousins and they're together, then they are actually setting a decent example for all the kids that are there, because it's very easy to get caught up in the whole rivalry. And I think, like, you know, I can't remember just anything on my tangent with football, no point, but you know what I mean? Like, it's really all just fun and games at the end of the day. It's not the 80s anymore. Like, nobody has that genuine hatred towards, you know, one side and the other. Like, it's good winding people up and getting involved in it and stuff like that. But I think we're all grown adults now, and we can, you know, we can understand that somebody supports a different team and has a different belief or whatever it is. Like, doesn't really mean anything for anyone.
Just gets left on Twitter now. That's pretty much it. That's where everyone does their moaning and groaning about teams and what have you. Right. Okay. So yeah, I just remember that story way back when. I can't remember who told me about it, but I was like, that's hilarious that you've riled up someone an adult enough to try and fight you. A wrestling show. That's just silly. Right, okay. So I got Griffin on the old Twitter machine. He asked, am I still considered an honorary KoE?
I suppose. Yeah. No, it was my first match I teamed with Griffin, Ryan Griffin at the time, Flying Ryan. So yeah, like, I was good.
And he's one of the most underrated wrestlers there is in the country. So
very good wrestler.
Yeah.
But yeah, that was great. Like, to be fair, me and him versus the Forgotten Cav and Dunbar, that was my first match on a show.
Dunbar pops everybody's cherries, so he does.
So I hear.
That was my first match.
Aye. Did he give you the same advice as he gives to everyone? Did he ask you if you were nervous and then told you it was good if you were? That seems to be this. Yeah. Okay. he's got a Rolodex of lines for first matches for popping cherries. So we've got Taylor Veit asking. Well, he asked two questions. One's a bit more controversial than the other. But I'll go for who's a wrestler you have a soft spot for that nobody else seems to rate. I don't know for this kind of question. I don't know if you want to pose it to Scottish wrestling as a whole, or if you just want to make it just worldwide. I don't know if going nobody else seems to rate, and then picking someone, they're going to sit there going, wait, nobody rate me?
Well, everybody rates Taylor Wright, but he's my one. He's the best. So
yeah, Taylor Wright is pretty good, to be fair, if we're talking Scottish wrestling. I think because I've had this conversation with Taylor Wright, so I think I know he means worldwide because we've talked about it, but he's really good. You know, if we're thinking Scottish, Ryan Griffin that we mentioned, there's a lot of good guys, to be fair, just kind of slowly under the radar, like, you know, that are actually pretty good when you
even watch them. Like, see when we were at FPWA and we wrestled Robbie and Ross, the Woke Academy. Yeah, they two were great, you know. And it's just like one of those things. There's just so much talent everywhere. And what am I getting phoned? No, sorry. There's so much talent everywhere, you know. And it's like every time you go somewhere new and you've not seen someone before and you're kind of not sure what to expect, and then you're like, oh, that's brilliant. And you watch someone for the first time live in person, and you go, "Oh, it's great!" And so,
I'll put in a third vote for Taylor Veit as well, because I got hold of some of the Combat League shows from up in Caithness, and he was just phenomenal. He did very little actual wrestling, but he didn't need to because he'd riled up the crowd that much; they reacted to everything. So it's like maybe did three bumps in the whole match, but it was one of the like heaviest reaction matches because he'd done such a good job in making.
He's one of these few guys, as soon as he comes out the curtain as well, he instantly makes an impact. You instantly think something about him. And that's like so impressive for people to do. Like, it's the second you come out and you think, oh, I hate that guy or something like that, you know what I mean? So he's great at that.
Second question is, which brother is better?
Neither. Both better at different things.
Yeah, that's true.
He's quite clever. He's left that quite open ended. He didn't say what better at what. So that's quite clever. Tactician.
We kind of see when we wrestle and stuff like that. We'll if we're better at a certain move or something, we'll just go, we'll have the other one take it. Do it. Like, even though, you know, one of us could do, let's say I could do an all right drop kick or something like that. I could do quite a good drop kick in comparison to everybody else. But since Marcus does such a great drop kick, what's the point of me throwing a drop kick? You know what I mean? So. I'll just let him do it. Same with if he's got a better standing moonsault than me, I'll just let him do the standing moonsault. So basically, I just don't want to do anything where I need to leave my feet. But I can.
I hate going up the top rope. Like, it's just a.
Yeah.
We can do it. We can do it probably more than people even realise. Or certainly fans may realise. I think people train with us probably know what we can do. But shooting stars, moonsaults, 450s, like. Pretty much anything that can be done, but like we just don't. Like, especially if you're bad guys, it's a waste.
Oh yeah, you don't need to do it. There's no point in scratching extra marks on your bump card, your hypothetical bump card, if you don't need to. Is that an important thing for you guys that you do? Like, if one's better than one move than the other, is that important for you guys marketing yourself as KoE as a package deal?
I'd say it's a, whatever one of us does, it represents the both of us. So, you know, like if one of us was to have a great singles match, you know, I mean, that's going to benefit the two of us. Mm-hmm. And same in a tag team match, like I think a lot of people who get new to tag team wrestling don't understand that you're only doing half as much. So half the time in a match, there's probably going to be one of you that doesn't really, maybe gets like a move in or something like that. Whereas maybe the other guy gets to do, you know, 2, 3, 4, 5 moves, whatever. And one of you is really going to shine above the other one. But see, as long as you're happy to be a tag team, it's going to represent both of you anyway. So
yeah,
that's kind of one thing you need to look at.
Yeah, that's why it's important. Like, we do market ourselves as a sole tag team. Like, again, there's some really good tag teams out there, and I think the ones that have been doing it a bit longer, like what Adam was saying, is like they can accept that. I mean, you know, they kind of know anyway. But I think we're so similar, like in terms of like our styles are quite similar, our athleticism quite similar sizes, similar heights. Like, but we also just complete, like our Twitter is obviously KoE. It's not Marcus King. There's not an Adam King Twitter. It's KoE Twitter. You know, the gear's the same. Like, none of us try and stand out really any differently to the other one. Like, and it's completely on purpose. Like, you know, we could do it if we wanted to, because we've got the best gimmick ever as a tag team, and we're brothers. So we could be completely different, and we could still be a viable tag team because we are brothers. Mm-hmm. But everything's done on purpose. It's like, you know, because like Adam says, if we do one thing or if we do a duo thing, like people go, like people genuinely say that KoE. People refer to us as KoE, like one of us is KoE. Like we'll say KoE talking to me. Like, at that, like backstage and things like that. So we're literally at that point where, you know, we're just seen as a collective. So
yeah, and there's a benefit of it's being so similar in real life as well. Like, I think it'd be hard to kind of be different because we're just into the same, like outside the wrestling as well, we're just into all the same stuff. So that's a similarity, really.
Fine. We've got Kwaku asking, apart from your brother, that's open ended here, who's your favorite member of Team Swag?
Quacker, obviously.
Of course, Quacker, what a guy. Legend.
I should ask, is there only three members of Team Swag?
Yeah, I think so. Is ADM member of
ADM, that? I suppose ADM is Team Swag.
He's the third member of KoE as well.
Aye, ADM's just KoE, so it's KoE and Quacker.
Mm-hmm. Well, actually, on with that, Eddie Castle asks, why is ADM like a proud ma to use?
Just like we're really, really good friends, to be fair. Like, ADM just loves us and we love him. So.
And he's very funny, you know.
Yeah, great.
And the best car journeys with ADM.
Yeah, that's like, yeah, absolutely. That's probably the next question right now.
I'm looking for ones that kind of segue on, and that's perfect. ADM asking, who's in their KoE car?
ADM, 100%.
ADM and a rotating four. Like, one weekend, the end of last year, we went to, what was it, Tarbert on a Saturday, and we had David Devlin on the car, and he was a great guest as well. He was a great guest to the podcast. And then we had Eddie Castle the next night when we went to Newcastle. He was another great guest.
I bet you had fun with that, Newcastle, Eddie Castle. I bet that was brought up.
Yeah, it was great. Working with Dirty Dango.
That whole car journey back was brilliant, man. That's it, like, literally, yeah, the best car, we always talk about this, like, who would you hate that? Like, why would you love to have in a car? Like, but anytime ADM's in the car, it's class. Like, that's what we say, ADM plus a special guest, or two special guests, if we need to.
And you can work out what a Colton car is. It's the opposite of a KoE car. And it's definitely because Colton himself is horrible to be with.
Is that why he sent us a gif of Chris Traeger air guitaring in the back of a car with Leslie Knope and Ben Wyatt?
Yeah, he knows the gimmick. Nah, Colton's great. He actually was a really nice guy, but we won't get into the details of like why it became the Colton car. But we want it to be a thing. Like, we're not going to tell anyone our Colton car. Like, that's not fair. We just want anyone that's in wrestling to talk about the fact that their Colton car is the car full of people that they don't want to be in a car with. Like, the worst possible 2-hour journey you could have, like, is your Colton car. And it's nothing to do with Colin as a person, obviously. It's just, it was just a story that's kind of snowballed from there.
Logan Smith's asked, who's on the Doug plane?
That's a KoE car.
That's a KoE car, yeah. We found out, right? So I think it was, Viper, when she went over to the States, because she has a dog, took her dog over, and but they were saying that, like, they basically, you, a bunch of people who have dogs that are moving to the States charter a private plane, I think, so they all chip in and pay for it so that they can go with their dogs on a plane, so the dogs are allowed on the plane next to them, or like, so. And I was like, so there's such a thing as a plane full of dogs, a dog plane, which sounds amazing. Like, that literally could be the best, like, journey ever. So the opposite of a Colton car would be your dog plane, because it'd be amazing.
Man, that sounds like, yeah, that sounds like the best thing I've ever heard of, is a dog plane. Amazing. Right, okay, so let's get some of these littler questions out of the way. So we've got Silent Assassin. He asked, what does the E stand for, Kings of? We already established that. We move on for that one. What's the thing with you both wearing odd trainers in the ring?
We have the same size feet.
Yeah,
that's about
nice and simple.
Yeah,
but when I see, I don't like, no, not OCD by any stretch of the imagination, but I don't like odd socks or anything like that. It just kind of sets my teeth on edge. So when I see you guys wrestling in odd shoes, it just, like, I watch it. Thank God they're bad guys.
Here's the thing. So we've had fans come up to us with odd shoes and say, "Oh, you're the reason I'm wearing odd shoes." So it's working to an extent, Colin.
Yeah, I hate odd socks as well. I can't wear odd socks. The only time I could wear odd socks is when we're wearing the odd shoes.
Yeah, because it evens out.
Aye, almost like double negative becomes a positive.
So. Fair enough. But yeah, that's pure evil if it's now spreading that folk are wearing odd shoes, because he is us. No. Reese asked, ask then, if you had a fight to the death against someone, would you pick a sword or a spear? It's a fantastic question.
Right, I know the answer to this, because there is a right answer. Would you two like to guess what would win?
Spear.
Yeah.
Range.
I could even throw it.
So they put it through like an animation or something like that. So it's like, you can find it on YouTube or something. I think it's YouTube. And I'd have thought, you know, you're more mobile with a sword. You can kind of get around and stuff like that. With a spear, you're kind of, you know, it's a bit more awkward. But apparently there's like no situation where a spear wouldn't win. I can't really remember the details, but yeah.
There you go.
A spear is the answer.
Backed by science as well, a little bit there. Yes. That's excellent. Let's see what else I got on Facebook then. Ian Skinner asking, favourite acronym?
KoE.
DBD.
Speaking of acronyms, now, right, it would rely on you either meeting Judas Gray or listening to past episodes. He's just asked DMG.
Yeah, what does that mean?
Oh, I love getting to tell people this. Right, okay. So DMG stands for Dead Mum Gang. What it stands for. So pretty much him and I think it's Major Matt Wolf from Joe Hendry's Academy. They founded this group, or although in writing it says he's the original founder, that because they both lost their mums, they're now DMG. So his question pretty much is, are you part of DMG?
No, but DDG.
The offshoot. Ah, oh, right, okay, yeah. He'll be glad to know that.
He did
ask it. He'd also added, the best part about this is he's met yous, so they better remember him. So, I don't know if you remember Judas Gray.
Nah, he was, yeah. We met him once.
We met him recently, actually.
At a seminar. And he was very flexible. But no, he was.
What a wonderful review.
What?
I love that. He's going to put that as his bio or something. Judas Gray, very flexible.
I've only seen so much of him, but he looks really good, to be fair.
Grant McIver asked, what's your favourite packet of crisps?
Pickled onion,
yes.
But I don't really eat them.
I'd
probably not eat a packet of crisps in about a month.
Give me chocolate in it,
Eddie. See, now, like 45 minutes ago, I liked you guys, but you know, that's the right answer. The favorite pack of crisps is the next packet. That's the right answer for me. as a ever expanding fat man in a chair. Right, okay, so back to actual wrestling, I suppose. Sammy Sparks has asked, LND versus KoE. So I guess that's a request. or anything.
Well, I think that's happening soon. It's not been announced, so I don't know if we can actually say it, but I'm sure it's happening soon. And I don't know, but we're out in a luck place where they work, so it might be happening in a couple of places. I don't know.
Very good. That's a little tease for the future. And I think last one I have on Twitter anyway is Alan, Big F and Tree. Asking, will the finest team in Europe be adding more gold this year?
Hopefully.
Well, thing is, it's silver that the ICW wins, and we'll be defending our other gold this year, hopefully. So, there's that. But hopefully more.
Speaking of gold then, so of course 2020 you guys became SWA Tag Team Champions. So that would have been your first Tag Team Gold. So what was it like? So that's 2 years in as a team and you're now champions. So was that, I don't know if you guys are big belt guys, was that just a cool thing that you'd worked to a point where you were champions?
Yeah, like I think that's cool. Like no matter how you look at it, that's the oldest promotion in Scotland, I think, or at least the oldest running one. It's been guys like Damo have held that, Mark and Jackie, all these people have held the belt. And it's just cool having somebody go, yeah, you guys are going to represent the tag division. So the SW is a big company, they draw big crowds, and to be given that kind of you guys are good enough. And at that time, we were happy with where we were at in terms of, like you say, being 2 years in. But we didn't feel like we were amazing. We felt good and we're confident in what we could do, but we weren't we're amazing. We should be holding gold everywhere. That was the goal to get to that, obviously, but it's still it's satisfying to have people recognize, your ability or your look or whatever. You as a wrestler as a whole or us as an act as a whole.
Yeah, that was only just off a Fatal 4-Way tag team match we did the first show we got in the SWA, and then just off that, they were you just could be champions. So, got the match and won the match, obviously. So, yeah, that was good.
But like I say, they do big. They only run two to four times a year, but their shows are always jam packed with either big names or just a large crowd in general. So it's not a bad place to win gold. And like I said, guys like Damo have held up those belts. Speaking of belts, and of course, end of last year, Fear and Loathing, ICW's version of WrestleMania, you beat Liu Kang-Sharp and Kreiger to become ICW Tag Team Champions. So at this point then, it would have been, I don't know if you count the pandemic year as a year, if you count it at all, but that would have been 4 years in, and now you're holding one of the tag team titles for the biggest company, one of the biggest companies in Europe. Was that one a bit more satisfying? Because it's pretty much the pinnacle of tag team wrestling in Scotland. What were your kind of thoughts winning that?
I think obviously it was amazing because that's been a major goal since we started. I remember going. Maybe just after I started training or something, going to, as soon as I turned 18, Marcus actually took me to one of the ICW shows. And I was I really want to do this. I think we both thought that night, we could get here and we could, win titles here and stuff like that. So to actually come full circle and win the belts there was amazing. But it's funny, I don't know, the SWA ones was it felt a massive achievement, and then that felt a massive achievement as well, obviously. But I feel we earned it. So, it was definitely, I felt we'd worked dead hard up until that point, and those were ours to win. So,
yeah, I think SWA was almost blindsided us a bit. We didn't expect it, even though we were working hard and we were trying. We were doing well. It kind of came out of nowhere. Where the ICW, I felt we were building to it, And it was a bit more of a focused goal. We never really thought about it, not because we didn't want to wrestle with SW or didn't want to be the champions, but we had one match and we didn't know if we were going to be back or anything like that. And then, lo and behold, the next show, we had the belts. Whereas ICW, it was obviously we did the whole lockdown stuff with the Purge, which we thought, again, coming out of lockdown, we did a good, the Purge were great.
So good. Stevie and Crowbar, yeah, two of the most underrated guys as well. Stevie, James, so smooth in the ring. Like, nobody really talks about it enough, but he's so good. And Crowbar, he hits you very hard.
Hardest part of the ring, so here.
Yeah, he is. He generally is. He loves getting hit hard as well. It's fun.
Yeah, but like that was great, and I feel like we did a good job. We had the first cinematic ICW match, like when we did it in the, you know, in the gym and things like that. Like, so, and then, you know, a Fear and Loathing match. Like the ending didn't go quite as planned as, but you know, these things happen. But Max Dead and Luke were brilliant. Like, we enjoyed the match. It kind of like we felt like we were kind of hitting a bit of a stride, but we'd also thought we need to almost like rethink, refocus, and I don't know if nobody was paying that much attention, to be fair, right? But we probably disappeared for like a good eight months or something, like,
yeah, 6-7 months.
Maybe 6-7 months. And like on purpose, and we went, okay, we're gonna come back and we're gonna do, you know, we had an idea for the promos, we had an idea, we wanted to get in better shape, we wanted to, you know, do something a bit different, like, and then like once we get back, the focus is, can we get the belts by Fear and Loathing, like either before or on Fear and Loathing? That was the goal. That was the conversations we were having, like with each other, with other people, like just. So when we got it, there was a sense of real satisfaction, because it was like, obviously the achievement's great, but you felt like you earned it, like you set out to do something and you, like, you know, you achieved it basically. Like, it was really, it was a pretty cool moment, to be fair. And again, like being trusted, I suppose, for lack of a better term, by the company, like there's so many heads in ICW, like obviously Dallas has got the final say, but there's lots of guys that have to agree on, or not have to, but that, you know, agree that you should have the belts and different things like that. And you know, it's like Cody said, like Cody Rhodes says, like the belts are real, wins and losses do matter. Like, you know, it doesn't matter to your ego so much, like, you know, outside of wrestling, obviously, like it's not like you've lost a fight, but you know, like in the UFC, but at the same time, it does matter for you, who you are and who you market. And for us, it is important, because that's, we want to portray that we are the best team and we want to be the best team. Mm-hmm. And if you were getting beat every 2 minutes, like, you can't be the best team, like, at the end of the day. So it was pretty cool.
Speaking of ICW, then we've got Daniel Micah asking, great, this is great, we're just segueing all through all these questions. Got Daniel Micah asking, which former ICW tag team champions would you most like to bring back to the company and face?
Polis, probably. We'll have to wrestle them. Who else has that been? Obviously,
Ashton and Rampage.
Oh, yeah, big time.
Let's see if I'll get EOD.
And they weren't champions, but I'd love to wrestle the Geezers. So,
I've got Sumerian Death Squad. That would be a bad, yeah.
Oh, aye.
Bad one there. London Kendrick.
Yeah. Oh, 100%. Yeah. Uncle Paul.
You've got Kings of Catch, of course, as well, which I'm sure when you've had a fair few battles in the past.
Yeah. Lewis trained us. So, he did a lot of our training. We've been training off a few people, but Lewis was big hand in training us. So.
And on that, to be fair, like, I think we're obviously talking about that ICW. Like, we obviously worked really hard to do that, but Demo and Wolfgang, massive parts of who we kind of became in the last year, I would say. Like, in terms of helping us, guiding us, training us, like, advice, everything. Like, you know, we were doing well and we obviously put the work in, but having two guys like that helping you so much and willing to help you, taking time, having long conversations, training you, was like immense, like, sort of. And that's why it's important to always learn. Yeah, we were on shows, we were on ICW, you could easily sit there and go. And to be fair, it's not really that common. Most people still train, and all credit to, you know, almost everyone in ICW still wants to train and still works hard at training. But that's why it's important, because we got so much better through their teaching and through their coaching, and like just soaking it all in like a sponge, so that we've got.
I think that's why it is important as well, because everybody on that roster is like, you know, every single show you go back to, you watch a match or something, and you'll see like Daz killing it. You see someone in so much better shape and all that. You look at like Jason Reed's shape, or he's cutting a great promo.
Jason Reed's promo is probably the best talker in the UK, I would say. I find it hard to find somebody better as a just a sheer pro, like good, great wrestler, great shape. But his promos are like up there. So if you try to get to that level, like, you know, he's picking up people because he's up here with that. Daz's athleticism is way up here with that. So you're trying to get up there. You know what I mean? Like, and there's so many guys like Theodorus, who's always good, but he's got so much better, which is hard when you're already good. Like all these guys that, you know, underrated guys again, like Levi, you know, just everyone's pushing each other. And that's what, like, that's just as important as just turning up to training and taking coaching as having a roster for that.
Everybody, I think everybody enjoys a backstage as well. It's really good atmosphere in ICW since we came back. Even like right after lockdown, it was a bit awkward. I think a lot of us hadn't met each other before and stuff like that. We used to do the bubbles and it was a new roster and stuff and everybody kind of, but since then, everybody's kind of gelled together and it's great. And yeah, like I think just the professionalism of everybody's sky high. It's great.
I'm hearing a lot of good, great stories like backstage stuff. I don't know, like, of course, this stuff that happened just after lockdown begun. But since the shows have properly come back, you do hear that everyone's kind of just, they're working for the promotion and not inherently working for themselves kind of thing. They're working to elevate the shows so the shows get more money so they could possibly be more valuable to the show itself. And it all works out in a cycle. But we'll say about Jason Reed. Jason Reed's got this amazing thing where he lets, I don't know how he does it. It's just a skill, I suppose, you pick up. But his timing, it's just, he pauses at the right spots to make the words more impactful. And it's just, his promo could be 2 minutes, but he could maybe have a 10-second pause in there just to make that last line pop more. It's just, Jason Reed's ace.
Cool.
So speaking of tag teams then, so Daniel Micah was saying that one for who won't face. Callum Bruce has asked, when are you coming up north to give Foundation the Future a run for their money?
We'd love to be fair. So.
Yeah, we'd wrestle, like, I think it's kind of funny, like you were saying earlier, like, would you message us? And, you know, people, I always wonder if, like, we'll reach out to most people, you know, and they might, sometimes they may ignore you in terms of booking you, and sometimes they'll say, oh, yeah, we'll let you know, but we'd work pretty much anywhere we are open to, like, people, you know, coming in and asking us to come and work somewhere or work with people, and we love to work in different new people and different tag teams. And a lot of the north is kind of untouched in terms of down here. You don't see a lot of the guys from up north down here as much as you used to, and vice versa. It'd be cool to see a bit more crossover from a lot, you know, from
because I guess it's beneficial overall, you know, for everybody. And it is such a good scene up there now as well. See, just seeing bits and parts of, like, you know, guys like Caleb and the young guy as well, Ronan King. He looks good. So,
he'll love that.
What you call him? Foundation as well. Mm-hmm. Really want to wrestle them. Maybe good.
Logan, the last question I've got through all the social medias is Logan Smith. Not that Logan Smith, different Logan Smith. Big Logan Smith. Big Logan. Who's their favourite tag team to wrestle?
The models recently was really fun. It was a really, most people would consider it a basic match, but that's like, you know, when it's not often you'll meet another team for like the first time, and it takes like, you know, a few minutes to put a match together, and you just go in there and everything's right. So positioning, footwork and all that, everything's right, and that's just a credit to how good they are. But I was really fun. Everything's so smooth working with them, and I know if we had like another match, it'd be even better. You know what I mean? So it's definitely a team that we'd love to get back in with and even do even more than we did. You know, but just in terms of smoothness and just how easy it was to do that match, models was good.
Yeah, and the young team, to be fair to them, like,
of course,
must have wrestled them about 100 times, but it's good. Like, that's
they're so good.
I don't even know if, like, they almost make out like they're not good. Like, if you're around them enough, like, they'll pretend they're not any good. And then not pretend they're not any good, but they always don't give themselves credit. And then you actually get in, you know, like, similar to what Adam's saying, like, obviously it helps being in the ring so many times, but positioning, timing, and just, they're similar kind of you know, thinking to us as well in terms of what they want to do and what they want to get out of the match, and unselfish and can be selfish at the right moments, and that's just, you know, what you want really. But we've not really faced any bad tag teams, to be fair.
And I'd say with the young team as well, I feel like every match we've had together, it's been better and better. And we always change it up, so we'll do something different each time and stuff like that. So it's keeping it fresh, and everything, it gets better, and just the more we're in together, it's smoother. But yeah, they're so good to work, so easy to work in a good way.
That's all the questions from the social media. It was loads. Yeah, you guys were very popular when it came to questions. And so a couple more of my own here. But first one, I've brought up the SWN 100. Now, this is a list that caused a little bit of controversy when it came out. Not the year end.
Yours was my confusion. How is he so much higher than me?
I was about to ask. Marcus, do you like pointing out that you're 11 places higher?
Do you know, see, when you obviously knew you were doing the list, I honestly thought you might have put, and we were hoping that again, see what it's all
about. Oh, just going as KoE.
Yeah, because that's what that was our goal. Like, that's our aim. So if we were on that as a duo, I would have been great. I'm always surprised, because I think he's had...
I've won more matches last year than you.
Aye, something like that. Like,
yeah. I think you had one more match, and I won two more matches than you did. I wrestled two British rounds matches.
I lost two of them.
Because there was one weekend I wrestled in Romania, and you were in Iron Gutters against Taylor Wright.
Aye.
Yeah, so. That might have been the difference. I'm going to bring up my stats now. I think it was a win-loss record. You know what? No, it also didn't help. Because you guys changed your name, I had to try and figure out which was which when I was getting results in. So that probably did not help me at all when it came to me figuring it out in the end. So it could have been a case I was attributing wins for Marcus that should have been Adams.
Our win-loss record must be quite good, because we don't lose very often. Not to brag or anything, we've just managed to convince people.
Next year can be KoE as a collective.
I will do that.
A bunch of singles matches, which we probably won't.
I'll remember. You mean you've already got a good start, because I start the judging at the 1st of December, so you've already got the title win in there, so that's always a good, it means you're pretty much probably going to be in the 100 somewhere.
I think we've had 3 defenses or something so far as well, so that's not bad.
There you go. It's not the hardest system in the world for points, but yeah, some of them got a bit weird when I was looking, how have you got this far? How have you got this high in here? Mostly because it's like Bobby Roberts and he books himself, so that's how he ended up on there. But you know, so, who cares? Right. Anyway, so last questions we've got then is our two usual ones that we ask everyone. The burning questions. The t-shirts are available on our T-Mill store about it. First up, what's your favorite dinosaur?
Stegosaurus.
Bones are
spikes in the back. So good.
What's the big one with the big neck? Brontosaurus? Is it Brontosaurus?
What's the Brachiosaurus? You think I would know at this
point? Aye, I think you're right. Brachiosaurus. The big long,
chunky Brachiosaurus
one.
Brachiosaurus,
right. Aye, that one.
The giraffe one.
Aye.
Giraffosaurus.
There's probably one called Giraffosaurus somewhere at this point.
Giraffosaurus.
There we go. Hey, yeah, I like a clever one. I like one that's outside the box. Did I put Thesaurus in my top 100? Got to check that. Anyway, and the other question that we ask everyone is, what would win in a fight, 2 sheep or 1 cow?
A cow, man. Easy. There's no chance 2 sheep are beating a cow. Cows are huge.
Yeah, cows are absolute units. See, sometimes, I don't know if, sheep are just really feisty or something, but there's no way. See, just on a visual standpoint, the size of the cows, I don't know what's in that grass they're eating, but what the hell? Huge.
Now, there is a video online of a cow running towards a sheep and the sheep winning. So I'm just saying that if you want some science in here.
Spear all over again.
It's the only video I've seen of it though, and I've kept it in my favourites for these exact questions.
Those sheep were on performance enhancing drugs, clearly.
Mega sheep. But no, that's it. That's everything. I don't think there's. I don't have any more in my notes. But like I said before we recorded, I didn't actually make that many because everyone else asked the questions for me, which is always great. Is there anything coming up? This episode's going to go on the 19th, next Friday. So, anything you want to plug coming up?
Don't know. Well, we've got the Squiggle. And when did you say this was coming out?
Friday. So what's that? That's the 17th.
Oh, right. Oh, soon. Yeah, yeah, we've got Squiggle coming up. So, and then in March, we've got a bunch of dates. I don't know. Yeah, you just look at our socials and you'll see them. Yeah.
Some haven't been announced yet, but we do have.
I think we're every weekend in March, we've got something. But first, Squiggle title match against the young team, and we'll batter them as per. The thing that annoys me about this podcast is I feel like there's probably like so many people we didn't put over, we should have put over, but you know, that's for the next one.
Do I throw out any names just in case you...
Tom Malone, he's been improving a lot, so see the last couple of years. Honestly, just next level, and Colton, they should be doing more.
Big Colton, Darren Blair, I don't know, Luke Cairo, Levi, Phil Chaos has, you know, improved massively.
Well, that's not his name.
Oh, sorry, Eddie Castle has improved massively.
So it's Kai Williams King.
Kai Williams King, yeah, guy's good. It's actually quite hardly. I really like enjoy working a lot, guys. I think people themselves know, like you know when they've got better or you improved or you're making strides in the arcane violence done a lot.
Oh yeah,
I like short them guys.
Yeah, look cool as fuck. Like really short space of time, like I've done a lot, and he's a really really good talker as well. If you watch his promos. Like, it's good. Just like, you know, shout out to all the tag teams we've wrestled. I don't feel like I've had any real bad matches, so it means everyone's it must be pretty decent.
We're quite lucky when it comes to tag teams. I mean, I did a once to watch list. Now, my only kind of rule was I tried to do Folk the Hunt 1 titles, and it was very easy still to do like a top 10. I was like, this is pretty good then. There's 10 teams at least that are about that haven't won titles yet that are. That I could easily make this list for, and then you got guys like yourselves and the Foundation and Glasgow Grindhouse and all these teams coming about that are just at the top of the mountains and
And we want to wrestle them all.
And batter them.
Stack them up.
Excellent. Well, where can people find you? We've talked about social media and we're wrapping up now. Where can people find KoE on social media?
KnockYou_KoE on Instagram and Twitter.
We don't use Facebook, right?
Nah. Go away, Facebook.
And for anyone who heard real names in that, ignore them. Don't add them.
Don't add me, please. If you'd be so kind.
Perfect. Well, thank you very much for joining me on this wonderful chat with KoE means SWN podcast. I can't think of anything clever to go with that.
Cheers, Billy. I hope I didn't waffle too much.